Good afternoon, church family. Come on, let's sing together. How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? All will see how great. How great is our God? Come on, you know this one. Let's sing it. How great. Yes. for Jesus. Yes, God.
Father, you are great and greatly to be praised. Thank you for all your blessings, for all your benefits, for all your bounty, for all your benevolence. Thank you for being our God and allowing us the privilege, precious privilege of calling you Father. Now, Father, we pray that you would empty me of myself and fill me with your Holy Spirit. Speak to me and through me as I pray. Use me in your service. Thank you for your Holy Spirit who abides with us even now. Now let your word fall on suitable soil. We want it to spring up in us abundant life and living. We want to leave here better people than when we arrived. Thank you for another privilege, for another opportunity to study your word. It's in the name of Jesus, the Christ of God, we pray. The great I am. Amen. All praises be to God, for he is worthy to be praised. We're just grateful that God has allowed us another privilege to share in the study of his word. Amen. Amen. Grateful for all of you who are with us today, either in physical attendance or in virtual attendance. I don't say that enough. I just want to let y'all know how grateful I am that you are here. Amen. In whatever shape, form, or fashion, I'm just grateful. Well, our next installment of the Divine DNA, the I Am Statements of Jesus, this lesson we want to call I Am Proof Positive. I Am Proof Positive. Today we'll look at the identity of Jesus. Turn with me to John chapter 20, verse 31. John chapter 20, verse 31. I'm going to read it from two different translations and a paraphrase just for points of clarity. The New International Version reads like this: "But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." The Amplified reads like this: "Says, but these have been written so that you may believe with a deep, abiding trust that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed, the Son of God, and that by believing and trusting in and relying on him, you may have life in his name." And then the Message Bible, verses 30 and 31 of John 20, say the Message Bible renders the text like this: Jesus provided far more God-revealing signs than are written down in this book. These are written down so you will believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and in the act of believing, have real and eternal life in the way he personally revealed it. I am proof positive, and we're talking about the identity of Jesus. On July the 9th, 1755, during the French and Indian War, after a difficult battle, George Washington gathered his troops and went to Fort Cumberland in Western Maryland. They arrived there July 17th, 1755. The next day, Washington wrote a letter to his family explaining that after the battle was over, he had taken off his jacket and found four bullet holes through it, yet not a single bullet had touched him. Several horses had been shot from under him, and his hat had been shot off his head, but he had not been harmed. He told them, and these are his words, I quote, "By the all-powerful dispensations of Providence, I have been protected beyond all human probability or expectation." Washington openly acknowledged that God's hand was upon him, that God had protected him and kept him throughout the battle. However, the story doesn't stop there. Here is the rest of the story. 15 years later, in 1770, now a time of peace, George Washington and a close friend, Dr. James Craik, returned to those same Pennsylvania woods. Upon arrival, an old Indian chief from far away, having heard that Washington had come to those woods, traveled a long way just to meet George Washington in person. He sat down with Washington, and face to face over a council fire, the chief told Washington that he had been a leader in the battle 15 years earlier. He had told him that he instructed his braves to single out all the officers and to shoot them down. Washington had primarily been singled out, and the chief explained that he personally shot at Washington 17 different times, but without any effect. Believing Washington to be under the care of the Great Spirit, the chief instructed his braves to cease firing at him. And then he told Washington, and I quote, "I have traveled a long and weary path that I might see the young warrior of the Great Spirit. I have come to pay homage to the man who is a particular favorite of heaven and who will never die in battle." Though George Washington was definitely not invincible, there is and was proof positive that God was truly with him and that God himself had protected him. John writes in his gospel, he says to prove that Jesus is the I Am, the very Son of God, the Christ, the Messiah, the only begotten of the Father. Last week, we hopefully established, like C.S. Lewis has said in essence, that Jesus cannot be considered just a great teacher and a moral compass. He was not and never will be a mere man. He was radically different and defiant of the religious practices of his day that were not like God. He is God incarnate. He is the Word made flesh. Jesus did more than just turn over tables in the temple. He turned the world upside down. Let's face it. I told you this last week. If Jesus lived physically in our world today, we'd have some problems with him too. Come on, imagine him standing up in Bible study and declaring, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one has access to God except through me." Or imagine him taking the microphone at a funeral and saying, "I am the resurrection and the life. If you believe in me, though you die, you will live again. And if you are living and believe in me, you will never die." Or imagine him on social media, on Facebook, talking about, "I am the bread of life." On Instagram, talking about, "I am the good shepherd." Or on Twitter, talking about, "I am the light of the world." We would be livid. This reminds me of a story. There were three lunatics in an insane asylum. First lunatic said, "I am Napoleon Bonaparte." Indignantly, the second lunatic said, "I beg your pardon. It just so happens that I am Napoleon Bonaparte." The first one said, "Oh yeah? Who says you're Napoleon Bonaparte?" Second lunatic responded, "God told me so." That aroused the third lunatic, and he said, "I did not." As funny as that is, the truth is, if Jesus lived in flesh and blood among us, a whole bunch of us would not believe him to be more than a liar or a lunatic. As we have learned, the I Am, the name I Am, comes from the Hebrew word YHWH. To be pronounced this holy name, the Jews gave it vowels and called it Yahweh, translated Lord in all caps, or Jehovah. It conveys the concept of absolute being. He is the one who was, he is the one who is, and he is the one who is to come. From everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. He is I am who I am. I am what I am. And God says to us, I do not change. I am here with you and I am here for you. Whatever you need, I am. We talked last week. We closed our discussion with the nine places, with at least nine places in the Old Testament where the Lord fulfilled or completed the name I Am to reveal more fully his divine nature and his gracious ministry to his people. We talked about Yahweh Jireh. The Lord will provide and see to it. Yahweh Rophe, the Lord who heals. Yahweh Nisi, the Lord our banner. Yahweh M. Kadesh, the Lord who sanctifies. Yahweh Shalom, the Lord our peace. Yahweh Rohi, the Lord my shepherd. Yahweh Sabaoth, the Lord of hosts. Yahweh Tsidkenu, the Lord our righteousness. And Yahweh Shammah, the Lord is there. So how does this relate to Jesus? I'm glad you asked. Y'all ask all the right questions. All these names refer to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus is Yahweh Jireh. The Lord will provide or see to it. Turn to Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. Philippians 4, 19. You found it? Say amen. Amen. Still looking? Say wait. All right. Reading from the New International Version. It says, and my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. Jesus himself will provide. Not only is Jesus a provider, the Bible tells us that he's a healer. Let's read Matthew 4:23. Matthew, the fourth chapter, in the 23rd verse. Got it? Good. The New International Version says, Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness among the people. Hallelujah. Yahweh Nisi, the Lord is our banner, our conquering king. What does Jesus have to do with this? 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 57. But thanks be to God, He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. New International Version. Yahweh M. Kadesh, the Lord who sanctifies, or the Lord who makes holy. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 11. 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, the 11th verse. Paul gives a list of sins. And then he says, reading from the New International Version, and that is what some of you were. Hallelujah. But you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. Got any used to bees in the house? I'm not going to ask about how many still are. Let's just stick with the used to be. How many of y'all glad to be a used to be? I used to be this. I used to be that. I used to be the other. But Jesus washed me whiter than snow. Hallelujah. Jesus is also Yahweh Shalom, the Lord our peace. John 14 and 27. John the 14th chapter, 27th verse. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. The world is full of peace breaking situations. Life happens. Life keeps lifing. But the Lord keeps giving peace. Any of you remember a time when the least little thing would shake you up? The least little thing would mess up your day? And how many of you know that the enemy is great at bringing one thing after another? Sound like y'all know what I'm talking about. And you remember when you would just fall apart? And now the same kind of stuff can happen, and you find yourself at peace. You want me to tell you what happened? It's kind of like a tree. The storms come and the winds blow and it rocks the tree from side to side. What it literally does is loosen up the ground around its roots so that the roots can grow down a little bit deeper. Once the roots go down a little bit deeper, a storm of the same magnitude can't move that tree. Why? Because the roots have grown down a little deeper. You want to know why the enemy comes at you with bigger stuff now? Because storms of the same magnitude won't move you. It is imperative that the Lord allow him. And let me emphasize that the Lord allow him to send bigger and better storms. And the reason is because if not, it wouldn't make us stronger. He is our peace. He is also Jehovah Rohi, the Lord my shepherd. John chapter 10, verses 14 and 15. John, the 10th chapter, verses 14 and 15. We'll talk some more about this one later. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, I lay down my life for the sheep. Hallelujah. Jesus is not only Yahweh Jireh, Yahweh Rophi, Yahweh Nisi, Yahweh M. Kadesh, Yahweh Salam, and Yahweh Rohi. He is Yahweh Sabaoth, the Lord of hosts, the Lord Almighty. How do I know that? I checked out Revelation 19th chapter, verses 11 through 16. Revelation 19, verses 11 through 16. I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and wages war. His eyes like blazing fire. On his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in white linen, white and clean. Coming out of his mouth is a sharp sword with which he strikes down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has the name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is the Lord Almighty. If you don't believe it, watch for him to show up in your situation. Whatever things are deemed impossible, the gospel says, with God, nothing shall be impossible. In other words, all things are impossible. With God, there are no impossibilities. Yahweh Tsidkenu, the Lord our righteousness. Second Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, reading again from the New International Version. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. How can I boldly go before the throne of grace? The throne of God? How can I boldly, as sinful as I am, go before God? Because Jesus has made me the righteousness of God. Don't look at me funny. You get to go too, because he's made you the righteousness of God. And then last but not least, Jehovah Shammah. The Lord is there. David said in the Psalms that wherever he went, God was already there. If I make my bed in hell, you there. Everywhere I end up, you are already there. Well, Matthew 1:23 says the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. I don't care where you go, Jesus is already there. Why? Because he is God with us. No matter what situation you find yourself in, he is Emmanuel, God with us. Therefore, when you go in the hospital, he's there. When you go in the courtroom, he's there. When you find yourself in unlikely predicaments and situations, he is always there. He is God with us. Exodus 3 and 14, where God declares to Moses, I am that I am. Ego I me. Is not the only place in the Old Testament where we find, when translated into the Greek, those words, ego, I mean. Where else do you find them? Over in Isaiah, in particular, chapters 40 through 55, God reveals himself again as the deliverer of his people. In Exodus, it is about their deliverance from slavery in Egypt. But in Isaiah, it is the deliverance from their exile in Babylon. They end up in Egypt, not because of stuff they did, but because of who they were. But they end up in exile in Babylon because of stuff they did. Come on. You got some instances in your life when you run into trouble, where you need to be delivered, where you were just there minding your own business and trouble found you. But we have some other instances in life where it's nobody's fault but ours. I remember an old song, and some of you might remember it. In that group I'm going to talk to this evening, a bunch of them not going to know what in the world I'm talking about. But the song went kind of like this. Ain't nobody's fault but mine. Ain't nobody's fault but mine. If I should die and my soul be lost, ain't nobody's fault but mine. Mother taught me how to pray. My mother taught me how to pray. If I don't pray my prayer and my soul be lost, ain't nobody's fault but mine. I stopped by to tell you, whether it's your fault or there's no fault at all, God is still a deliverer. Isaiah also introduces in these chapters, 40 through 55, the suffering servant. That is filled in those chapters. The prophecies of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the Messiah, who will deliver God's people ultimately from everything. Repeatedly, God himself emphasizes his own uniqueness and supremacy with the ego I me statements, regularly translated, I am he. Turn to Isaiah 41 and 4. Isaiah 41 and 4. I'm going to read it from the Amplified Bible. Who has performed and done this, calling forth and guiding the destinies of the generations of the nations from the beginning? I, the Lord, the first and the last, existing before history began, the ever-present, unchanging God, I am he. Yes, indeed. Isaiah 43 and 10. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, reading from the New International Version, and my servant whom I have chosen so that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me, no God was formed, nor will there be no one after me. Hallelujah. Go down just a few verses. Isaiah 43, 25. Reading again from the New International Version. As he who blots out transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. I am he who blots out your transgressions, not for your sake, but for my sake. Sounds like grace to me. And remembers your sins no more. And then last but not least, Isaiah 48, verses 12 and 13. Isaiah 48, verses 12 and 13. I'm reading this one from the English Standard Version. Listen to me, O Jacob and Israel, whom I called. I am he. I am the first and I am the last. My hand laid the foundation of the earth and my right hand spread out the heavens. When I call to them, they stand forth together. Hallelujah. These few verses serve as merely an example to show God in relation to his people. Much of what he says here in Isaiah is realized and accomplished in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'll give you three quick examples and then we're out of here. Jesus is creator of all. Don't believe me? Check out John chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. Jesus is the creator of all. When he makes the claim, I am, he is claiming to be creator. Secondly, Jesus is the first and the last. Revelation 1, verses 17 through 18. Revelation 1, verses 17 through 18. Reading again from the New International Version. When I saw him, John says, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead and now look. I am alive forever and ever. And I hold the key of death and Hades. Hallelujah. Jesus is creator of all. Jesus is the first and the last. Just like God is creator of all and is the first and the last. And then last but certainly not least, Jesus is the means by which his people's transgressions will be blotted out. Just like God is the one who blots out our sins, Jesus too blots out our sins. Turn to Acts chapter 8. Verses 32 through 35. Just in case that sounds familiar, it's the story of the Ethiopian eunuch. And God sends Philip to the desert. And when he gets to the desert, he tells him, he sees this Ethiopian eunuch, and he tells him, go join yourself to that chariot. When he gets there, verse 32 says, this is the passage of scripture the eunuch was reading. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before his shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth. Then the eunuch asked Philip, tell me, please, who is the prophet talking about, himself or someone else? Then Philip began with that very passage of scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. I know, I usually close with a story. So allow this to suffice. He was despised and rejected by man, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we did not esteem him. Surely he bore our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Just a little more of Isaiah 53. When they first heard this passage, they didn't know his name. Well, thanks be to God, that's not my testimony. I know his name. Do you know it? What's his name?
Jesus.
What's his name?
Jesus.
What's his name?
Jesus.
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing his word. It sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me, the invitation is extended. Father, we thank you for that name above every name. Jesus. He is the great I am. He is our creator. He is the first and the last. He is the one who blots out all our transgressions. Thank you for Jesus. Now, if there's one here who doesn't know you in the pardon of their sins, bring them down the aisle. If there's one who's in search of a church home, because they're not growing where they're going, lead them down the aisle. It's in the name of Jesus, the Christ of God, we pray. Amen, and thank God. The invitation is extended. To accept or reject. Right quickly, want to remind you, if you haven't taken care of your financial obligations, your tithes and your offerings, make sure you take care of that before you leave. Hallelujah. Also, we want to announce that there are two services scheduled for this week. First of which is tomorrow. Services for Brother Robert Gillespie here at the Willa Avenue Baptist Church Sanctuary. Visitation will be at 10 a.m. Service will be at 11 a.m. And then on Friday, April 19th, the services for Sister Wanda Levine be held here at the Willa Avenue Baptist Church Sanctuary. Visitation will be at 10:15 and services will be at 11 a.m. Be sure to visit the congregational care page on our church's website for a complete listing of bereaved families and a complete listing of health, people with health concerns. Let us stand. Singing, oh, oh, how I love Jesus. Father, we pray now that you would be a blessing in the lives of all of our bereaved families. Give them what they need. Grant them your peace. Grant them your comfort. Grant them your strength. And then, Lord, for those with health concerns, we lift them up before you, realizing that you're able to heal every disease and sickness among us. You're the God over every sickness and over every disease. So heal is our prayer in the name of Jesus. You've done it all before, now do it again. We look forward to the praise reports of your healing power, your comfort, and your peace, and your strength. Now it's unto you, because you're able to keep us from falling and present us faultless for your throne with exceeding joy. You're the only wise God. To you be power and majesty, glory and dominion, now, henceforth, and forevermore. It's in the name of Jesus, the Christ of God, we pray. Amen. God bless you.